Good afternoon. Oh, my mic must not be on. I come from a call and response tradition. Good afternoon. That's thank you so much. I know that you all have been waiting with bated breath for this session, so I want to get started. So I'm Mark Fowler. I'm the CEO of the Tannenbaum Center for Interreligious Understanding. Our mission is to combat religious prejudice, to promote justice, and build respect for religious difference. And we're honored to be here. And I'm particularly honored to moderate this panel. So let me introduce, and all of our full bios, well, not the full bios, because that would take the whole book. Their bios would take the whole book. But let me introduce Scott Appleby, the Marilyn Co-Dean and Professor of History at University of Notre Dame's, is it Koch or Co?
Keough
School of Global Affairs. Catherine Marshall, Senior Fellow at the Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs, and Professor of the Practice of Development, Religion, and Conflict at George Washington University.
No, Georgetown.
Georgetown. Georgetown University School of Foreign Service. And Mark Gopin, Director at the Center for World Religions, Diplomacy, and Conflict Resolution, and the James H. Lowe Professor at George Mason University School of Conflict Analysis and Resolution. So our panelists, and also all members of Tannenbaum's Peacemakers in Action Network Program Advisory Council. So I'm excited because I don't get to see them like this. Mm-hmm. So thank you all for making time. What we noted kind of in our prep session that we are, I think this is the 16th year of the this actual convening, and thought it might be an interesting place to start to talk about what's different about the role of religion in conflict resolution and peace building than it was 16 years ago. What's different, but similar to some of the conversations we've heard in other panels, what's the same? What are some of the same challenges that we're addressing today that we were those years ago? And anyone can begin.
Well, since we had a prep session, I've got four things that are different. One thing is that religion is, in the analysis at least of religion, and I think in the practice, religion is less isolated as a factor, kind of an independent variable unto itself. And it's understood more as being embedded in social, political, cultural context. That seems obvious. But I know I and others 15, 20 years ago were really teasing out the religious dimension, which distorts the picture in many cases. It's not that the religious part is unimportant, but it's so conditioned by the context, the setting, the economics, climate change, environmental things. So we see religion, I think, a little bit more sophisticated way as being embedded in a variety of factors. Second, related, is we recognize that religion plays a role in and is complemented by and reinforced by and challenged by other sectors or parts of society. So development and all that goes into economic development, religion has a real role in that and always has in addressing questions of poverty and growth. And there's more self-awareness, I think, on the part of people who study and interact with religious actors of how importantly linked religion and healthcare and development and these other areas are. The other third thing that I think is different, but I really would like to see what Mark and Catherine say about this. I think after many years of people like us banging on the table about this, there's a little bit less tendency in the government and among some scholars and even in civil society to instrumentalize religion, to think that religion is something we can manipulate for foreign policy goals or for whatever goals, that not only backfires, it lacks integrity and it misunderstands the role of religion. I don't know how far we've come, but I think we're a little bit, I want to say that since we've all been on this crusade for a while, I want to think that it worked. And the other thing I think has changed is that maybe more than 15 years ago, the focus was, if not almost exclusively close to it, on religious leaders and officials and the higher-ups, if you will. And I think over some decades now, we've all recognized that that's part of the story. It's an important part of the story, but if you don't understand the grassroots, don't understand religious actors, and they have different interests, different motivations, different partners at different levels. So the analysis would be really distorted if you just focused on the important, but just the religious leaders alone at the higher level.
As always, Scott has great points, and I agree with them all. But my basic answer is that it's complicated. What we started with as a sort of sweeping narrative was the secularization theory that almost completely ignored the religious dimensions of many aspects of global affairs, of world affairs, as well as domestic, of course. And that, I think, has obviously changed. There's been a huge amount of research. There's a lot more knowledge. But you still have the phenomenon that I call the glazed eye phenomenon. When you say, what's religion got to do with it? Even in Council on Foreign Relations events, there's not a very clear answer. It's not intrinsically part of the analytic structure. So you do have a very wide range from people who are very sophisticated and very thoughtful about what's involved to people who really still instinctively rebel against taking a religious factor into account. So I think that's something. The other, we always are dealing, I have to confess that I'm sort of allergic to the word religion because I think it's too broad and too sweeping and can get you into trouble. I try to use it as an adjective so that at least you say religious ideas or religious practices or something. But you still are dealing with a balance between religion is the problem and or part of the problem, and religion is part of the solution. And if I'm going to be sweeping, because you're asking for a sweeping comment, in the period when this initiative was started, I think there was a predominance of religion, this fear of religion, and the aftermath of the terrible terrorist attacks and war on terror and religious extremism to what I hope is a richer religious engagement approach that looks at the grassroots, at the leadership, at the good, bad, and the ugly, the beautiful, the different dimensions of the world's religious traditions. And you know, we do use a figure very commonly. I don't think I've heard it here, but that 84% of the world's population has some religious affiliation, which means it's big. It's a very large factor, but it's also very varied, very diverse, very complicated.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, as a practitioner on the ground and as an analyst or writer of books, it's very complicated about the good news and the bad news. So there's some very good news, and that is some internal learning that I've seen in American foreign policy and in a number of Middle Eastern governments, that the weaponization of religion was a terrible idea, and that it unleashes things and it manipulates millions of people in very destructive ways. Mm-hmm. However, there are other regimes that have gone ahead and weaponized it even more, especially political parties that have seen it in their interests to weaponize religious differences, in particular in India, but in other places as well, and in the United States. You can't divorce Christian nationalism that we were talking about at lunch from the weaponization of Christianity for the purposes of political gain. At the same time, the good news is that states have also seen positive peace building as beneficial. 20 years ago, the EU, when I would talk about these things, the eyes would glaze over from the ambassadors. Now there are departments, and there are departments doing very good things. Same thing in the United States, at AID, at the State Department. Very proud of some of the State Department folks that many were my students who have innovated. The problem, and what remains the same, is that it's a drop in the bucket by comparison to the weaponization of religion and the amount of money going into that. So we still have a competition where religion and peace building can't even get out of the starting gate when you compare the budgets. One of my friends looking at the Israeli-Palestinian tragic conflict all of these decades, he said he couldn't even find less than 1% of major spending in the last 40 years that went into serious competition between religion and nationalism and religion and peace building. There was just no competition in terms of investments, foreign and domestic. The other piece of news that's changed and I think is good news is that 20 years ago, 40 years ago, I didn't have students who were doing excellent work inside intel agencies and inside the military. That was like a territory where, whoa, they were part of the problem. They were the ones that did what they did. And now some of our most sophisticated thinking is coming out from intel people who understand that religious conflict is a disaster and an uncontrollable one. And their problem is that their hands are tied by politicians who have discovered the power of votes for hatred when they don't have anything else of substance to say. And that's our headache now for the future of democracy. Not the military, not intel, but the political uses of hatred in democratic systems or neo-democratic systems.
So I'd like to then, let's go a little bit deeper with this because I think it's an important point. And Catherine, both you and Mark are talking about this and I want to hear what you have to say, Scott, as well. So is this particularly new though, this weaponization of religion, or what is new about it? Because people's beliefs, their practices, their cultures that are related to religion have been used against them, or they have been made tools of regimes and individuals. So what is different now? And I love what you said about substituting the weaponization for religion for actually content or platform to stand on. It's, you know, fear-mongering. So is it just being used differently, more effectively through social media? What do you think?
Well, I'll just say briefly that I think that there's a chicken coming home to roost here, and that is that, I want to be delicate with my words, but really it's almost...
I don't think you have to be.
it's you know...
They're all grown people.
I don't think that the West took enough responsibility for, ever since the 1920s, of using jihadis to do stuff in the world together with allies in the region, especially through the fossil fuel industry. And that kind of weaponization, which I think since 9/11, we've worked very, very hard globally, millions of Muslims, Christians, and Jews, to basically undermine that appeal and some really good counterterrorism that has basically eliminated that as appealing as it used to be. However, I saw the destruction of the Syrian Democratic Forces in front of my eyes because none of the sides supported them, invested in jihadis, and now are best friends again with Assad. And it's very, very heartbreaking to see this. It's almost like a temptation that we all have to use religion as a weapon. So I don't think there was enough discussion of admitting that mistake and consciously making global treaties on that. Mm-hmm. We've made all sorts of great interfaith between elite religious folks, but we haven't said, this is what states commit to. And I had a good argument in the State Department meetings that we had years back in the committee. We were talking about the mistakes we've made in interfaith, but I said, yeah, but what are you guys saying? You made a mistake in terms of the uses of religion. And it's very hard to admit past mistakes for states, but I think that we have to have a self-conscious, globalized treaty on the non-use of religious ideas for killing and for hatred.
I think it's a complicated question because we are dealing with the phenomenon that I think all of us are grappling with from many perspectives of the polarization and the increases in a number of different kinds of tensions across the world, but they do take very different forms. And the way that the religious side comes into it is very rarely very straightforward. I'm always struck, I've been on panels on both Nigeria and the Central African Republic, where on the same panel, you'll have one person saying this conflict has absolutely nothing to do with religion. It has nothing to do with people's beliefs, even their organizational structures. It's about herders versus cattle, versus farmers. And someone else saying this is basically a religious conflict. So you have the polar opposites even within a given situation. So I think that the religious role and the way that religious ideas are manipulated is indeed a very critical issue. But I don't want us to lose sight of the much broader roles that religious communities, that religious practices play. And let's take COVID. Clearly, the health dimension is a very large part. There's a large part of health in a number of societies that's actually delivered by religious organizations. The vaccination issue had a very strong religious element to it, but so did the social protection. Mm-hmm. In other words, the capacity to be responsive to recognize the most vulnerable in societies. And then you had, predictably, in the COVID pandemic, as with the plague, you go all the way back, every major event of the kind causes increases in conflict and the tendency to identify and stigmatize certain groups. And that's clearly happened. But it's all part of this mix of polarization and the political vertigo that I think we're seeing in the world. And I think the point here is that the religious institutions, the religious leaders, the religious beliefs are a part of this complex web that we need to understand much better than we actually do. Mm-hmm. And we should never ignore it.
I think following right on from that, I think the answer here, the big headline, is the consolidation, enhanced by technology, enhanced by the military, of the power of the nation state over many decades. The consolidation of power of authoritarian states, both illiberal states and our own country, of so much power in the hands of the state. I have a good friend who's an imam from South Africa, and he spends half the time here, half the time there, and he says, the besetting sin of Islam in his lifetime has been idolatry of the state. That is, that the Islam has, as do other religions, a prophetic dimension to it, a critique of power. But because of, for various historical reasons, including the sense that we've been oppressed, we've been sidelined, marginalized, we're fighting back against that. But the remedy for so many has been to co-opt or to be part of that state power of coercion. And that's certainly not true only of Islam. Russian Orthodoxy in general has always been very cozy with the state. It's in the DNA. But today in Russia, you see that magnified. In our own country, similar patterns of certain religious groups wanting to be part of a power structure that their prophetic side, what I would consider their more deeply religious historic side, that might be just Pollyannish on my part, would say is not how these various traditions understand themselves identifying with the power, the secular power of the state. And there are sometimes naive, sometimes calculating attempts to marshal that power, to try to influence it, to turn it to their own ends, is often misbegotten. What states don't reward the prophets in the community quite as much as they reward the lackeys. And so there's all kinds of dynamics that work to have religions in some way or another, competing for the goods of the state. And that, in most cases, backfires in terms of religions being independent, prophetic or otherwise. And it makes the lines between the state and the religious groups, in some cases, very blurry.
So I want to hopefully dig a little bit deeper and maybe shift a little bit. In one of the sessions, I think it was in the session last night, there was an assertion made, I believe, by the ambassador that religious identification was playing less of a role in diplomacy and foreign relations. And I think what he was speaking to was the idea of just one religious group being identified and focused on, as opposed to now it seems that it's more broad. He did not have a thought, though, as to whether it was good or bad. I'd love to know what each of you think. Do you believe that religious identification is playing less of a role, or is it perhaps playing a different role in diplomacy and foreign relations today?
Well, I'll turn this to the stated topic and a little bit less on diplomacy, more on peace building, mm-hmm. if I could. Mm-hmm. And to pick up on Catherine's opening comment, where she cautioned us to be careful about big words like religion, any kind of generalization is fraught automatically because you have to go on a case-by-case, country-by-country basis. Mm-hmm. But I believe it's the case in peace building. One of the things that we didn't get to, the what has not changed so much, at least for the last 60 or 70 years, the Catholic Church's presence in certain parts of the world in terms of peace building has shifted after the Second Vatican Council and the, if we take the case of Colombia, say, liberation theology in Latin America. And the presence of church actors, here I'm talking about those who are building peace. These religious communities, as you saw in the last session, as was said in the last session, they're internally plural. There are all kinds of actors in the religious community, and so we can't generalize about any of them. But there has been, in certain Catholic contexts, now for several decades, a greater engagement, maybe not in the diplomatic corps as much, mm-hmm. but working with the diplomats and working with other mediators and trainers. So if you look just, I can give you three cases, but I'll stick to one. You look at the Philippines, Colombia, and other places in Burundi, but you would see in the case of Colombia, which is 74% Catholic, 23% Muslim. I'm talking about Colombia. 57% Catholic, and what was I saying? Colombia is, 74% Catholic and 23% Protestant. And then a 20% Afro-Colombian indigenous and a smaller percentage of native indigenous peoples. What you see in that setting for several years now is the church being very important, the diplomacy and the peace building, the mediation that goes with this complicated peace process, which is now in its fifth year, a 15-year implementation process that brought the various parties in Colombia to the table. And the church plays an important pivotal role, not only in trying to mediate between FARC and other guerrillas and the state, so many of these people are at least nominally Catholic, but also more recently, that is the last five or six decades since Vatican II, identifying with the indigenous people and their rights and standing up for the ethnic groups, as they're called in that context, who were among those most devastated during the war, because they lived in very fertile lands, they were often massacred, they were displaced from their lands. And so in that context, the Catholic Church has played a fairly consistent role constructively, even though they're dealing with actors on the ground who have been in a very brutal war for a long time. We could talk about other cases, but I think there is some consistency there.
Going back to your question, I do put myself in the Madeleine Albright category of I'm a chronic optimist who worries a lot. And when you look at the conflicts that are taking place, I mean, Sudan recently, South Sudan, plenty of others, it's hard to be an optimist and to see a clear line of peace building with the examples. There are some specific examples. But I've been working now for about 25 years on sort of thinking about what's religion got to do with AIDS to zebras, climate, gender, you name it. Mm-hmm. And one of the things you get coming back from the religious actors constantly is that the sectoral approaches, the sort of dividing the world into water and diplomacy and so forth doesn't make much sense when you approach it from a more religiously inspired lens. And I think that applies to identities. Mm-hmm. When you think about identities, the sort of complex relationship of your religious identity, your ethnic, your national, your gender, all of the, your disability, all of the different identities that we talk about, and how the religious identity plays in that varies so much right. by country that it's, you really do have to look at context. Context matters in trying to understand how the structures work, whether it's a hierarchical Catholic or whether it's the Catholic sisters working invisibly yeah. with the cloak of invisibility, which is often a characteristic of women. So you see many, many different ways that this plays out. And I'm hesitant to pick up your generalization.
Well, I think the thing about it is that I'm not per se looking for a particular answer, but just wondering with the conversations that we've been having for the last, you know, 20 some odd hours, where do these things play together and how do they play together, or at least what we should be looking at in terms of the interplay?
I think what I got from what the ambassador said was that you no longer oversimplify, because we've complexified things, and that's always good in terms of diplomacy. So not only have military people and intel people studied conflict resolution, are aware of it, they've studied culture and conflict resolution, religion, identity, lots and lots of people in organizations that do non-official diplomacy through religious traditions are also engaged. And so in that way, you're not going to have a diplomat now come. I mean, we've taught people at the Naval Academy and all these places. They're not going to come, you know, and say and immediately assume China is Confucian. You know, we don't oversimplify. You know, like the brilliant lecture we got before from Mayfair. So we're all starting to see more complexity. The problem is that this has led to a collusion, unconsciously, of religious hierarchies and secular hierarchies. So that we tend to ignore the wisdom from below, the wisdom of what to do, the wisdom of where to go. You know, there's a Talmudic statement that probably is also related to the Stoics of Ezehu Chachama Lomed Mikol Adam. Who is the wise human being? The one who learns from every person. And so the whole style of what we're learning about deep conflict is that nothing is gained, nothing is solved from the top. So we've started to try to expand the notion of where is the wisdom? The wisdom, and certainly most hierarchies are male, and of a certain kind of religiosity. And we're trying to insinuate and instigate a greater attention to youth, to women, not just to hear them, but actually they have the ideas. Mm-hmm. They know better than we do. And everywhere in the world, they know better than we do of what is to be done. Just like I did with those imams who'd never been talked to from Afghanistan. So that is a male hierarchy, and yet they were closer to the ground and they understood. And one of them said to me, there's no religious conflict here. So I'm sure you've heard this before. I said, well, what is it? You know, he said, oh, talk to ISI. You know, it's the Pakistani intelligence. So from his perspective, he'd been working hard to have a humanitarian Islam. And these guys come over the border with all sorts of money because it's in some other state's interest to keep things unstable in Afghanistan, you know? And where does that money come from for intelligence agencies in that region? Well, the American budget is pretty much part of that too. Mm-hmm. So it changes everything just to have a conversation with a simple imam from a village. Right. You know, we need to reverse the whole concept of where peace building and conflict resolution comes from.
So with that, let us then talk about the role of women in conflict resolution and peace building. And maybe to kind of herald a little bit to the first question, what has changed, and what remain the challenges?
I think you should talk first.
I wonder why.
No, you've done the most.
No, I think you have two separate strands, which obviously we're trying to bring together. So the first one is the growing awareness and horrifying numbers about the exclusion of women from peace processes, which is reflected in 1325, the resolution, and with efforts to at least to take a look at the pictures of people at the table and to bring women's voices into a much broader discussion. That's another feature of it, is that when you start talking about peace building involving women specifically, the definition of what's peace expands substantially to the very early stages of identifying sources of conflict to the critical periods following conflict resolution. But then you have the question of religious women, and you have a phenomenon which is not universal, but which you see in a number of situations where you have the feminists being suspicious of the religious women and the religious women being rather suspicious of the feminists and not quite sure even what the vocabulary is and what people represent. And what that has meant is that you have this Bermuda Triangle where what is most invisible is the role that a lot of religious women play, in fact, or can play, or could potentially play in the community level, what I guess we call track three now, at the community level of peace building, but also actually at whenever there is a table where you have at least the representation of the women who have the understanding of the community. So finding ways, first of all, to understand better the roles that women are playing, and to find better ways to break down some of these historic, psychological, sociological barriers that would allow us to understand much better how women in different traditions. And just one of the interesting issues on that is what I referred to before is the cloak of invisibility, mm-hmm. that there is ironically an advantage in some cases. I mean, there are what, legends of kings and queens who've gone out and learned by being invisible. The fact that women are not seen as likely to be a threat or to be serious players, to put it more crudely, the fact that that means sometimes that they can do much more. They can break down institutional barriers that men simply don't think they can even touch. So you have a whole sort of, you have a mosaic of stories there, which I think is only partially recognized.
I just give you an example. I totally agree with what Catherine is saying. In that divide, I saw that especially tragically in Afghanistan, okay. between Kabul and the other places. But on a positive note, in terms of looking for inspiration, since 2011, been on the streets in Jordan and Turkey working with Syrian refugees. I had been working inside Syria before then. And there's this mental health center in Amman that I take my graduate students to every year. And this is amazing, two women who started this mental health center for a series of kids, who are seven, eight, nine, 10, to try and get them back into their homes despite PTSD. They all are suffering from PTSD at the same time that they're healing these kids. I've never seen a more brilliant group of women, and the psychologist happens to be a young man and his wife, just the most brilliant application of psychological wisdom and therapy and healing in everything that they're doing. It's like you go into a paradise in the middle of Amman. They're all veiled. They're all covered head to toe. And they're dealing with, they were dealing one year with this trans kid, this kid who didn't know if he was male or female, and in absolute distress. And here, it makes people crazy in America. People go crazy because our notion of male and female is so thin, or we're so fragile that we're ready to go to war over one innocent kid. And this, traditional Muslims, all of them, and I've never seen a more beautiful way of helping a child to figure out what he's going to do and what the family's going to do. So all these stereotypes and all of these assumptions, we go, we learn, we're humble, and suddenly the wisdom comes from the ground. So I think that that's what I'm seeing is that women are teaching us around the world enormously important things.
You know? I'll just briefly echo these points. The data about religions in America is pretty solid. When you extrapolate and get data on the question I'm about to address elsewhere, it's a little harder to make generalizations, but here's a thin generalization. When you lose the women in a religious community, you lose the community. Christianity in various forms, as we all know, is in decline in this country. And part of the studies about that is when in the Catholic Church, for example, you know, at times the hierarchy seems to have a plan. What can we do next to alienate the women who are at the core of the invisible women that Catherine refers to? So it's not only the case in U.S. religions, but elsewhere, women are practice more regularly. They are more faithful by certain indices, not looking to the person's soul, but generally speaking, the pillars of the community are women. And that requires women in so many contexts to be adaptive, patient, and to maneuver in creative ways right. around the obstacles that are set before them by a patriarchy. So I'll give you just one example here. A minute ago, I started figuring what country I was talking about. I was talking about Mindanao first. So Mindanao in the Philippines, the ratios there are, it's a long-standing, decades-long civil war in Mindanao between the Catholic population, which is about 57%, Muslim population, 23% indigenous populations. And there has been a long-standing breakthrough in the religious agency for diplomacy and peace building in Mindanao, the Bishops Ulama Conference, kind of well-known, all men, by and large, and they have made breakthroughs, and they have been part of the peace process and made some differences in how the government understands the process and so on. Well, that's one of the, we all know different cases differently. The three of us have been in different parts of the world. I spent a fair amount of time in the Philippines in the 90s and early in this century. And I was struck by the Muslim women and the Catholic women I knew there who were united in complete, mostly invisible support of this prominent and effective Bishops Ulama Conference. And one of the interesting dynamics is in both cases, the women I knew best had internalized the faith tradition, sometimes from the teaching of bishops and the males, but were practicing it in a way, I'm not trying to disparage the men involved at all. That's not the point of my kind. It's not that they weren't good people, but they're also at a different kind of niche in society, and they've got different responsibilities. And they're also accustomed in both cases to being served almost hand and foot by the women who are committed to them, and they just take it for granted. But it was the women who were really the spark that moved the day-to-day, month-to-month. There are zones of peace in Mindanao. There are all kinds of dialogue centers. It's a very flourishing environment. Without the mostly women in civil society in these communities, there would be no progress on the ground and no filtering up to the peace process at all. And I remember one particular, we had been giving the bishops of Mindanao, a few of us, a 10-day workshop on peace building, because bishops, I kind of naively thought, well, you're a bishop, you should know about peace. You serve the Prince of Peace. I don't mean that disrespectfully. I was naive, because of course bishops aren't trained to be peace builders in the technical sense that people are trained. They have to learn it. So to their credit, they were taking a workshop in Mindanao because they were important players in the peace process and still are in that part of the world. And we had this 10-day workshop that was facilitated by these Catholic and Muslim women. The sessions were framed, and it was a beautiful thing. And at the end of the two of us from Notre Dame who were leading the workshop, we just, as you would typically do at the end of the 10 days, we thanked the bishops and we thanked the other people there, and we said, but of course the people without whom this would not have happened were the women. And so we thanked them by name, and then we looked at the, this isn't being recorded, is it? We looked at We looked at the faces of these wonderful guys, wonderful men, but the thought of pausing to stop and acknowledge and thank the women was clearly a new idea to them. And they awkwardly, this is something we would take for granted, but they awkwardly kind of said, yes, thank you. And so it was just for me a little microcosm of how central, more disproportionately so and happily so, women at the grassroots and kind of mid-level society in many of these conflict settings are crucial, without whom religious communities would have a much diminished role.
Well, I think we should turn now to hands are flying up, to questions in the audience. Why don't we start in the back? Yes, yes, please. And then to you, yes. And then here in the front. And I see you.
Thanks, Reverend Fowler, and thank you all. My name is Anna Page. I'm a U.S. Army chaplain. And this question is going to sound like it's for you, Dr. Appleby, but I think all of y'all can answer this. Dr. Appleby, the work that you and Dr. Lederach have done around strategic peacebuilding has been foundational for how I approach my role as an advisor, as an Army chaplain. And I just wonder if y'all as a group can speak to the use or the efficacy of strategic peacebuilding as a legitimate strategy employed by institutions in areas of influence or regions of influence.
Thank you. I just carry John Paul's bags around the world for him. He's the real genius. I was just fortunate to write a couple articles with him and work with him for many years. And John Paul Lederach, some of you will know his name, is a very influential peace builder who comes from a Mennonite background and has been influential around the world in mediation, conciliation, and really is one of the great architects of this term strategic peacebuilding, which is built, I won't give the full lecture, but it's built fundamentally, it seems simple enough, but often, as John Paul will be the first to say, simplicity is the other side of complexity. It's really built on the art of relationship building, which in a complex way. What does it mean to build relations across sectors with friends and enemies? How do you sustain those? So strategic peacebuilding refers to the strategies one has to bring, first of all, different levels of society together in some kind of coordination. So Sant'Egidio is trying to resolve the conflict or be a mediator in Mozambique, and it knows the people in the government of Italy and they need grain and they get this shipment. They're a little lay Catholic mediating community, Sant'Egidio, but they have connections, they have networks in military, in government, in civil society. So in one sense, it's coordinating at different levels strategically at a critical moment in negotiations when the warring parties may need this or that push or help or resource. There's a kind of strategy around that, but it's built on, if Sant'Egidio didn't have relationships with the Italian government that go way back, it wouldn't have worked. They couldn't pick the phone, and they had friendships in Mozambique itself, having worked with AIDS victims and with disabled people in Mozambique for many, many decades. So strategy is, in that sense, the strategy there, but also the relationship building on the grassroots among disparate parties. And, I directed a peace institute for many years, but it wasn't until about midway through it that I finally learned from John Paul what peace might mean in these contested areas. It doesn't mean the cessation of hostilities or the bringing of some kind of utopian peace or even the kind of economic productivity one would expect at some point. It means creating spaces, platforms, he uses many metaphors, zones of peace in which the fighting, which will go on in these longstanding conflicts, has been contained, so to speak, so that ordinary life can continue. And again, women are very important in reconstituting these communities that take a moratorium on violence because their mothers are saying to the guerrillas, this is a no-arms zone. and here is where we begin. So these are platforms of peace where you can kind of pause for a moment, so to speak, and begin to think, what does it mean to move forward rather than just dodging the bullets every time? The final thing I'll say about strategic peacebuilding, John Paul, his metaphor is among many in a great book that I commend to all of you called The Moral Imagination. And he says, you have to imagine conflict differently, imagine peace differently, and imagine that these communities were zones of peace, communities of peace within a warring setting, a conflict setting, are like spider webs. Well, what are you talking about, John Paul? When he said this to me, I said, you know, get over your midlife crisis, get back to the sociological stuff. And then I learned later that I had to say, I'm sorry. He was exactly right. And that when you have a spider builds a web and the anchors of that web are solid, they're connected to a solid surface. And if that's the case, then the spider web is resilient. Because often the web itself is very fragile and it can be destroyed very quickly. But if the anchors are there, the web gets rebuilt pretty quickly. And he uses that metaphor to talk about community activists, community, again, not only the women, but people in the local communities and in the region who are the solid anchors. And when this, because peace can be disrupted very easily, it's much easier to have the militias destroy every hope of peace. But if the anchors are there, what does it mean to build those relationships that are longer term and anchored in the community and then rebuild the web? You know, it's going to still be threatened, but, and maybe even the notion of progress as we sometimes understand it may not be exactly right, because he does a lot on time and what does progress mean in this context. Anyway, that's part of what strategic peacebuilding is, but I commend John Paul's writings to all of you. John Paul Lederach.
Can I add very quickly to there are two anchors that I think have to be part of the strategic thinking, and one of them is governance, the anger at corruption and the failures of governance are such a critical factor. And then the more positive vision of development. And sort of trying in strategically to break down the barriers that exist between these different worlds, the peace building world and the development world, and as well as the humanitarian.
I'd like to hear more questions.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you so much. My name is Lisa Sharon Harper, and I am the president of Freedom Road and author of a few books. And so here's my question. And I recognize I'm asking this question in a room that was not going to all agree on the response to the question, but I do think that because of who you are, it needs to be asked, because I think you have a lot of wisdom to offer. Given the history in America of the use of religion, to move politics by leveraging especially issues like abortion, to gain state power, and the reality that that state power has in fact been gained, and now we're seeing the result of that being the rise in authoritarian leadership here, or at the very least at the rise in the desire and planning toward authoritarian leadership here, and of course then deepening divisions racially, gender-wise, every possible way, would you apply some of the principles that you have talked about from the stage today to chart a way forward that is a peace-building way on the issue, particularly of abortion and women's rights, women's issues, women's health?
I'd like to take that first. I'm so glad you asked that question. The fact is that we've been a little bit down on religion, organized religion, but we can't forget the fact that religion has always been ambivalent, ambivalence of the sacred, Scott Appleby's first work on this. And the fact is that the social gospel movement was transformational in the late 19th century, that the civil rights movement was deeply imbued with spiritual values that cut across ecumenical lines, Jewish-Christian lines at the time, and all of it made major changes and advances. However, the mistake that was made and that continually is made by progressive movements is that they tend to focus on win-lose options, on winning the Supreme Court, on winning an election. And that means that we win, you lose. And we know now from conflict analysis and resolution that no one ever loses. They just get even later on. Mm. And so the fact is that as long as we do not embrace with love and compassion our adversaries and try to bring them into a dialogue and conversation, and particularly, as I've learned from my Baptist friends and from my Jewish friends and many others, with gestures of kindness and compassion, not just talk, then we can have transformational relationships in the way that John Lewis taught and that Martin Luther King taught and that many others have taught over history, even Lincoln after the war. And I think that that religion, A, has a positive role, but B, we continue to think in black and white terms of we win, you lose in our politics and in our social change conception. Whereas the neuroscience of this is very exciting. There's neuroscience on prospection, on future, and on imagination, and the way that people imagine together. And what I've sort of noticed why women take a prominent role in many parts of the world is that they're very comfortable with the fluidity and uncertainty of a lot of talk that's very confusing, and out of it emerges imagination of a different future. And so I think that we need to do that in this country desperately across partisan lines. There was a fair number of conversations going on about abortion and anti-abortion in particular among women. But again, we cannot blame peacebuilding for complete lack of funds by comparison to what is going on in this country for war making. When the budget for war making and populism and hatred and their budget of Fox is on the balanced by a budget for engagement with love and compassion across lines, I think we're going to see major evolution of the American identity, which we have not seen yet. We're just seeing a devolution of identity at this point.
I think Mark has made important points, but I would just add that I think one of the most difficult issues within these discussions of religion in society is the changes, the huge changes in relationships between men and women. And a lot of religious traditions are clearly still struggling with one of the realities of modernization.
Great. There was someone over here. Yes? Were you the person I called on before? No, the gentleman behind you. Yes. And then we'll come in the back, and then we'll come up here.
Thanks. This may be off topic a little, however, in terms of... Neil Blumhoff, sorry. Rabbi Austin, Texas. In peacemaking, which can be so fraught and so misunderstood, whether intentionally or not, would you care to comment, where do you see a future of AI in helping dialogue?
I've been doing a lot of fretting about AI like everyone else. I was just in Malta with a bunch of amazing Ukrainian scholars and activists thinking about, and there was one amazing scholar from Cyprus, Konstantinos, whose specialty is AI. And really, our minds are gripped by fear at this point. I think it's the climate change fear, and there's many things that keep us down in the amygdala, but there's also opportunity with AI. And we're not there yet. Most people are thinking about the terror of say, QAnon together with the AI techniques. I mean, we know that. We've seen Twitter change, you know, for the worse and so on. We're based on bad intentions. But I think that we're just at the beginning of thinking how creatively it would be for all of us to use our AI devices someday to think about the best case scenarios for the future. How would we get there? So it's going to be a competition of goodwill, how we use AI. And this is, again, where the traditional progressive community has really got to get into a new form of messaging and a new form of relationship with mass amounts of people. And AI is going to figure into that very, very much. So thank you for raising it. It's cutting edge.
You can say something very
quickly. I'll pass on that one.
I know people are asking questions very quickly. I had the pleasure and honor of giving the commencement address at a university in Dallas, Pennsylvania last weekend called Misericordia, which means the heart of mercy. And so what do you do? So my commencement was basically this. You are graduates, as I've got an honorary degree, I'm joining you as graduates of the heart of Mercy University. Who's going to hire you when you say, I'm particularly qualified for this job because I'm from the heart of Mercy University? No one's going to hire you for that unless they're very shrewd, was my line. Number one, everything you've learned over the past 4 years will be obsolete by Christmas. If you don't believe me, ask ChatGPT or talk with me about ChatGPT. A lot of things are going to become obsolete in the way we know and the way we work. What will not be obsolete as the storm approaches, and I use storm in a lot of different ways, what will not be obsolete is the quality of Mercy. And you can use the quality of Mercy in a lot of different ways. I refrain from quoting Portia, Merchant of Venice, Act 4 scene. Anyway, but Mercy as a quality of the soul, as a quality of character, in which, as they're working, and this is a university that graduates a lot of people in healthcare, nursing, so forth, and they will be overtaken technically in various ways, who knows how, by technology and AI. I don't think that AI, ChatGPT, and so forth will corner the market on Mercy and on compassion, on insight, and on dialogue, and on understanding, and that's what that university has tried to cultivate in these young people, and they need to find ways in their lives, as that will be a valuable commodity, which is not the word you want to use for it. And so you can spin off that. I mean, I think that's where peace building and the movement toward tolerance and understanding and compassion is so needed. That's the quality we want to celebrate.
In the back, please.
thank you. Mary Evelyn Tucker, Yale Forum on Religion and Ecology. Thank you so much for this panel and for your life work on these issues. I am just trying to introduce something you've probably thought about, but in the future going forward, the peace building and is going to have to address the environmental crises, as we heard about food and water and climate change. And so my question is, this is where the wars are already happening in shortages, especially of water. But I guess my question is this, because we've been seeing this for several decades. So to what extent can we be proactive, anticipatory, and peace building for full sustainability and flourishing in parts of the world that we know are already on the edge of destruction? And of course, the Pope's encyclical, Laudato Si, I think is really bringing together this cry of the earth, cry of the poor. But love to hear what you all have to say about environment and peace building.
Well, I want to tie to the compassion comment. I didn't even know what Scott was doing with that work. My most recent book from Oxford is called Compassionate Reasoning. And it's a neuroscience argument for the centrality of compassion to future visioning and why it makes people joyous rather than the kind of terror and fear that we have by being afraid of the future, afraid of what's going to happen to our grandchildren and so on. Compassion and service with compassion is like a tonic to the brain. It also happens to be at the core of several key moral decision-making theories over history, Kantian moral sense theory. And I'm arguing that we all need to really work on ourselves and our minds with a kind of approach to extreme complexity that is coming, that generally brings people to a place of fear and fighting towards a collective notion of what is good for all. What is the categorical imperatives that we can all agree to? What is the compassionate thing to do in very complex situations about immigration, et cetera? So we all need more training and to be committed to that and across religious and secular lines. A new approach to citizenship that's both religious, secular, and ethically focused with responsibility. It's a new educational system. So there's a whole bunch of things that I think we can do, and we are in crisis, but I think that in crisis, people have risen to the occasion in previous crises in history, and I think that's what we need to do with the environmental challenge. It could bring us together, depending on the training that we're working with in our minds and hearts.
I think the story of Cassandra is all too apt in this, in the sense that so much of what's happening and is going to happen is very clearly visible. And we can see it. There's a lot of analysis. There are reports coming out. every day. And I guess the question for this group is the degree to which we can look to some really deep leadership coming from religious communities. And I think the Laudato Si is an example, the patriarch, the ecumenical patriarch, and some other leaders are really offering both the challenge and the call to action and the wisdom. But the sense is that it's very fragmented, and it's situated somewhere between the very prophetic, which people don't hear, and the much more mundane of sort of science-based targets and so forth. And I think that there's a real need for some coalescence, some real linking of the different strands, which of course is what you do. But that is the immediate imperative.
And just to go back to a point, Mark, that you were bringing up before about the role that peacebuilding, by its very nature, to bring people together who are often combatants, and to bring them and create environments where they can actually have conversation, dialogue about and create what matters to them as opposed to what they've done. Is there anything else that you'd like to say to respond to this question? Because it did come up, this whole idea of we're going to have to interact with China. We're going to have to interact because of some of the major constraints with climate change and other things. So are there the lessons from peace building that can be applied very, very concretely to these relationships that need to be built?
Well, I'd be happy if we start relating in a new way to the people 2 miles away in rural areas. Mm-hmm. So we don't have to go to China to figure that out. Of course, a global exposure to this, I mean, when I see a Sunni and Shia women friends who are now both running from a dictator, but their parents killed each other in the 1980s, and there they are embracing in order to save the children, in order to work together. You know, it's humbling, and you learn something. So what I found around the world, and I just met a wonderful Polish researcher and Bosnian leader on moral exemplars. And there's an ancient wisdom in Talmud that says, Ezehu gibor ha'oseh sono la'ohavo. Who is the true war hero? The person who can make an enemy into a friend. And so I think that skill, and that it's an ethical skill, but it's a psychological skill, is going to be the deciding factor in whether America can evolve into a can survive as a democracy, and then can also help the rest of the world with its immense wealth in a way that that's what I'm looking forward to is an evolution of mind and skill focused on the nature of winning. What is it to win? And it's not 51%. This whole notion that elections are what wins. Not really. I don't want to live in a world where 49% of the people are ready to kill me. I would much rather, you know, have to compromise and have a bipartisan thing, and 90% are with me. I just, especially as a Jewish, you know, rabbi person, I'm very conscious of when I have to get out of town, you know, and I really don't like 49%, you know, and we're just on this knife's edge. I'd much rather see the majority community build these skills of love despite differences, mm-hmm. and then we can all feel a lot safer about the future.
You, I think we're still on the question you were asking, and you mentioned Laudato Si. I want to say something about Pope Francis on this question, and I'll preface it by saying we don't want to lose the odd, challenging, radical, unsurprising, troubling nature of religions, because they can be that. We can't. I often tend to do this myself, so I'm saying using a secular framework for interpreting what religious leaders do is inevitable for me, at least. At the same time, there are aspects of religion, of faith, of religions that are scandalous to us. Pope Francis, in this case, Pope Francis, I have great, great admiration for. I tell my children, that's why we're Catholic. This Pope is why we're Catholic. That said, and the Catholics don't believe that the Pope is infallible every time he opens his mouth. And you know that this pope is taking a very controversial position on Russia and Ukraine, in which he has resolutely refused to condemn Putin. He is holding out he met with Zelensky, and Zelensky was not pleased, however you would phrase that. It was not a great coming together, because the pope is insisting upon a kind of, this is not how the pope probably would put it, neutral playing ground. Let's just start talking about reconciliation. Let's go deep into that. And my response to that is, oh no, you can't not condemn this. You can't not take sides on this. And then there's a part of me that says, I kind of trust him, but I don't understand. It doesn't mean that I trust blindly, but this is what I mean about religious leaders and people deeply formed in the faith, which just this pope certainly is, and others. Bring the brothers Karamazov now if you want to talk about the oddity of religious religions in Russia. And there's something there that is scandalous to us, at least to me, and yet there may be an opening there. There may be a dimensions of it that I don't have enough faith to really appreciate.
I have a little story on this, that Archbishop Ndungani, who succeeded Desmond Tutu, I was in a car with him at a time when the Zimbabwe situation was very fraught, and I was asking him about it, and he burst out, you can't be a mediator and an advocate at the same time. Mm-hmm. And that's something that stuck with me, mm-hmm. that I think all of us, seeing the polarization, being bewildered by some of the arguments of the opposition, what is the problem? What is driving some of the evil in the world? That we know that we need to understand it, but we also need to be willing to see the red lines. And you know, in Afghanistan, there are red lines. And how do we navigate somehow between trying to make peace, to heal the world, to come to the better society that we know is possible. Mm-hmm. Because we do have the most extraordinary opportunity in our generation to see a world where there can be justice, where there can be fairness. And how do we navigate between the need to try to reach out and to be understanding and compassionate to all, and to try to move in the right direction?
I want to slightly add to this just a little bit, Scott, that you know I'm arguing that the beginning of a nonviolent society is the willingness to morally reason differences, and so that therefore the people who are the metropolitans of the world, as you well know, the Orthodox, are solidly against Kirill, and they have stated this clearly. And that's a certain moral position, and I admire it, and it's a turning point for Orthodox Christianity. At the same time, I admire the Pope that wants to stay a space where reconciliation might be possible at a certain point. I've seen both act. As long as we're operating from moral principles and we come to different conclusions, I have great faith in the future. Mm. It's when hatred is used for power that we are in deep trouble. And when humanity is not even as good as the chimps, mm-hmm. that's when we're in trouble. But we are very much in good shape when people have moral differences on how to achieve the good. Then the brain is operating really, really well, and I think in a very spiritual way.
Great. We have time for just a couple more questions before we conclude. So here and here and in the back.
My name is Bruce Knotson. I represent Unitarian Universalists at the UN. Before that, I was a Foreign Service officer for 25 years. And throughout that entire time, I said there ought to be a bureau in the State Department on religion. And it never happened, except when I left the Foreign Service and the Obama administration came around, Sean Casey brought a whole, something like 200 faith leaders, I was one of them, and we advised the State Department on all sorts of foreign policy issues, human rights and development, and we even had a meeting with Susan Rice at the White House. And I just, don't you think it's a good idea? The other point I want to make is that the United Nations actually has a religious advisory board that's permanent, that they talk to all the time. And I think it would be a good thing for foreign policy. What do you think?
Yes. Yes.
We were all, I think, saddened when the Trump administration came in and kind of shut down Sean's office, basically, that Religion Global Affairs office. We thought, at least I thought, it was a big step forward, not only because of the religious leaders being convened and so forth, but because he hired, you know, over two dozen, I think, experts, some of my students, maybe some of yours, experts in local religion, you know, not just generalists, but people who understood religious dynamics in different parts of the world, who could advise and have local expertise or regional expertise, real expertise around this very important topic. And that was a great step forward, and then it kind of got eviscerated.
One caveat. There's a continual spending of huge sums of money to get people with big hats together in fancy hotels. And it's very nice. I'm very glad. I even have students that are secretly working with very powerful Muslim and Jewish, you call them extremists or extreme conservatives, who are really keeping many things from blowing up right inside the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. However, they are not religion. Religion is millions of people, billions of people. And when we frame it for the United Nations, we can't again say, bring together the big hats. Say, bring the big hats in this hotel, and then consult with representatives from all the major religions that focuses on women, on young people, on Sufis, on excluded minorities, on indigenous religions globally. There's so much wisdom out there. And we need bodies internationally that embrace that and learn from it. They don't have to do everything they hear, but they got to listen.
All of us were volunteers, and we never got any money and no hotels.
Hi, Guthrie Graves Fitzsimmons with the Baptist Joint Committee for Religious Liberty. Your comment about 84% of the world being religious made me think about the 16% and the 1.1 billion people in the world who don't claim a religion, and that being the third largest religious group in the world. So what experience do you have engaging the organized non-religious in peacemaking?
Well, I've worked with the non-religious for most of my life and career. So that's, I think the issue is much more finding ways to build the kinds of bridges that we need that recognize the diversity and the complexity. I mean, the 84% is a Pew number, which is religious affiliation, which is, I think, much more about identity than about belief and behavior. But you're quite right that there are an awful lot of people in the world for whom religion, their beliefs or their practices is not really their driving force. And to some extent, they're the ones who make foreign policy. So I think that it's the issue is trying to create more of the mutual understanding. And in order to do that, there has to be a recognition of the complexity of the way people operate and the way they think. Somebody once said to me, everybody has faith. It's just a question of what they have faith in. That's the use of the word faith. But you know, you take an issue, I mean, one that I've grappled with a lot, you know, family planning. How do people make decisions or not make decisions, avoid decisions about whether or not to have children? And think of all the factors that are involved. The money is involved, the mother-in-law, the community view, mm-hmm. the health care that's available, mm-hmm. the religious teachings. I mean, all of them come in very different ways into one of the most basic decisions that people make in life. So I think dividing the world into the people of faith and people not of faith is a very false dichotomy that leads us into a lot of trouble.
You don't use the word religion. I don't use the word faith, because so much of the world's religions are rituals, practices, ethics, and a lot of those practices and ethics can be shared and are shared. There are many villages around the world where people are sharing Hindu and Muslim, you know, rituals and practices. And so ethics and the practices of ethics we have in common with everybody who's unaffiliated. So there's you know, the deists and other, I mean, Kant established this a long time ago, Grotius. I mean, there's many people who are moving towards universalism with a traditional Christian background, and we find a common place in what we do with our hands. Yeah. And I haven't seen any problems with my students in finding that when you work at it.
So this is our last question, and I just want to say one thing just about the whole idea of nuns and unaffiliated. The thing also to take from that data is that people who identify as unaffiliated or not being related to something in particular, they have ritual and practice that they engage in. So it's not that it's kind of like an abandoning of religion. I'm no longer religious. It gets very dramatic in the way it's spoken about, as opposed to people just noting that in terms of how they identify, that they are saying that they're not aligning themselves with anyone in particular. They're going to the buffet. Last question.
Thank you. I'll be quick. As you all were speaking about the role of women in peace building, especially at the local level or the community level, I realized that I had a couple of concerns, so I'm hoping you can help me feel better about this. One is it reinforcing stereotypes about what women's work is? You know, that this kind of peace building at the local level is about relationships, and it's about care, and it's about emotional IQ, and is that something that we should be concerned about? And I think the second concern related to that is that we know that women's work is kind of undervalued or seen as not as serious or not as rigorous or not as legitimate. So should we be concerned that whatever is happening at the local level might not trickle up if it is women who are leading those efforts? So help me feel better about that.
This may make you feel worse. The when I said the thing about the heart of mercy, I was not just talking to the women. I think, and I can understand the concern about having rhetoric or discourse reinforce what we don't want reinforced. I get that. On the other hand, when I've witnessed, observed, and admired the women I was talking about in the context, the virtues that they bring to bear are virtues I wish I would see more in both genders. And so I don't associate it, I associate with those people what I think is at the heart of peace building, which is relationships, which are difficult and which require a certain kind of quality of character and persistence and knowledge. I mean, I think the things that, so the thing that could be minimized in this is that work, not the people who are doing it. If because they're doing this work, that somehow that makes that work, it's the other way around. It's that this is very difficult work. It requires stamina, it requires patience, it requires commitment, despite the obstacles by women and men. And I want to see more men and women having this heart of mercy, which is at the heart of strategic peace building.
If I can come back to the debates about invisibility, I was working with Susan Hayward on a book for USIP on women coming from religious perspectives on peace building. And one of the themes was invisibility. And I think the editor thought that this was really great, that invisibility was good, whereas we said, no, that's really not the point. That it does have some advantages, but it also means that there isn't a focus on what they do, yeah, and there isn't support for it, there isn't funding for it. So I think that I understand very well your concern and share it, because it's part of the sort of social dynamic. But I have to say that, you know, I'm getting on in age and have seen this for a long time. And I did start very much with what I call the Annie get your gun theory of gender, which is anything you can do, I can do better. That's an old song for but over the years, I do think that, first of all, you know, we talk about the 30% women. I don't know what percentage there is here, but until you get to 30% in a group, you don't see a real change in the dynamic. And with that, you do see, I think, and from this, from my lived experience. But I think even more, you do see changes in agendas. I mean, if you do surveys of women in rural villages, what, and men, they want different things. They want water, they want transport, or they want vaccination for their children. So it is this question of inclusion, of seeing the different sides and the different qualities. And yes, the questions of, you know, are men and women different generically and don't stereotype and all of that is absolutely critical. But you even in the discussions with religious communities, you have to get beyond that to what is a richer tapestry when you have the full diversity, the full pluralism represented.
Yeah, it's a very confusing question. It would take a few hours to really thrash out the give and take of it, and I respect the question. I thought about it a great, great deal. It's just that I've grown up on the Talmud, but I also grown up on the Tao Te Ching, and I really look at power very differently. And for me, power is the power to survive and the power to make change, even when people don't know what you're doing. And the fact is that I found time and again that men are trapped in hierarchies that are very severe of what they have to do, from a gang to a militia to some patriarchy, and they don't have a choice. And somehow the women are making abilities and power, like Ellen Johnson in Liberia and a whole series of other women in Liberia, because they were disenfranchised from formal hierarchies. And I want to grapple with that, because power plus ethics is what matters here, the ethics to make a better society. So I want to learn from these women networks. It doesn't mean that I don't want women to be professionals in Kabul, but I really, really wish we had both worked on the professionalization of 1-2% in Kabul, and then had a network of women across the country influencing their traditional families to reject the Taliban, reject the corruption of the government, and make change together. You know, we didn't. We didn't have a strategy for traditional women. We didn't see the power of that. So I respect what you're saying, and I think you're absolutely right that our intelligence is far lower until there's an equal number of women and men in high professional standards and educational research. But there's something else going on, too, in terms of a Taoist approach to power and to change.
And so now our strategy is going to be to thank the panelists and to go to the reception.